गुड इवनिंग स्टूडेंट्स।
गुड इवनिंग मैम।
गुड इवनिंग मैम।
गुड इवनिंग। गुड इवनिंग। हैव यू गॉन थ्रू द क्वेश्चन बैंक? आर यू एबल टू आंसर द क्वेश्चंस?
यस मैम।
यस मैम।
या नाइस। टुडे द एजेंडा ऑफ टुडेस lecture is I would like to complete IO systems and also part of unit 5, the Linux system, so that in tomorrow's class we can complete part of Linux and again Windows.
Okay ma'am.
So by tomorrow we will be completing all our 5 units.
Yes ma'am.
Right. This is the second part of unit 4, IO systems. IO system is a part of operating system that manage and control IO operations and IO devices. The overview of this chapter is we would start with what is IO systems, then what is IO hardware, applications, application IO interface, kernel IO subsystem. These are the parts of IO systems, and how to transform IO requests to hardware operations. Finally, streams. Performance is not included in your syllabus, so you can just omit it. And then what are the objectives of studying about IO systems? We are exploring the structure of IO subsystem, which is a part of operating system, because it deals with all IO operations and all the IO devices. So that is the objective of this chapter. Learning the structure, principles of IO hardware and its complexity, and also provide the details of the performance aspects, how and in what with what speed this IO operations takes place. IO management is a component of operating system, and it is quite important because there are several IO devices connected to a computer system. For instance, you have storage devices like disks, tapes. You have transmission devices like network cards, modems, human interface devices, which are keyboard, mouse, monitor. All these are the external devices or IO devices that are connected to a computer system. Therefore, it is essential to learn about the IO system, how it deals and handles different IO devices, and how does it manage them, what are the performance aspects, what are the methods to have communication between computer system and IO devices. Computer system here means CPU, how CPU communicate with the IO devices. And what are the types of devices, and then how those devices are connected through ports, bus, and there are device controllers that connects various devices, and then there are device drivers for every device. Device drivers provide a consistent uniform interface so that it is in a similar manner you can access any type of IO device. You need not know, the system need not know about the variations in the IO devices. That is possible through device drivers. Device drivers are those programs that it has all the device details and provides an interface to the IO subsystem. What are the IO hardware? Look at here, these are the variety of IO devices, storage, transmission, and human interface. As I told you, storage includes hard disks, transmission, modems, cards, interface, human interface with which human interacts. Human interacts with keyboard, mouse, monitor. And what are the concepts related to IO devices? Essentially, this port is nothing but a connection point. Okay, you might have seen that there will be behind this cabinet, you can see some ports open here, where you can insert a keyboard, monitor, and a mouse. You are also getting in the front also there are some ports on the this cabinet, that is through which devices are connected. What is a bus? Bus is a common channel through which all the devices are connected. Like this, there will be a cable running to which multiple devices are connected. This is nothing but a bus. You have different types of bus. They can be connected through daisy chain devices. I mean, devices are connected through daisy chain or direct shared. Daisy chain means you connect device like here, and this further will get connected here, and which will further get connected to the final port. This is known as a daisy chain organization of devices. And then there is a common bus, which is known as PCI. This PCI bus is the it is the common bus system that connects processor, memory, subsystem to the devices, to the other IO devices. Expansion bus is used to connect slow devices. Controller, every IO device has a controller, which is nothing but the electronics that has the port, the bus, and the device, details. And it is most of the time integrated into the device. Sometimes you can find the controller separately on a circuit board. And this controller can have processor, micro port, private memory, bus controller, and so many other components. Look at this. This is a bus structure. This PCI here, peripheral component interconnect, is a common bus which is running through the system, which connects this processor and memory subsystem to various devices which are IO devices. Here you can see these are the disks based on SCSI standard. These are the disks which are based on IDE standard. Disks have different standards and protocols. And there is a graphic controller that connects monitor. There is an expansion bus. Typically, this expansion bus is used to connect to slow devices. You know, mouse, keyboard, these are relatively slow. So those kind of devices through serial port and parallel port are connected by means of an expansion bus, which further gets connected to PCI through an interface. And then this is IO hardware. In this, these two things are quite important. Try to understand here what I'm saying. Okay, the every IO device has data in register, data out register, status register, and control register. Status register contains bits that can be read by the host. This status, what is the status of the IO device, whether it is busy, whether it is available, that is the status. control register. It is used to hold the commands that is being given by the system for the device to function. And then this data in register is this one. This is read by the host to get the input. Means input from IO device to the host. Host is nothing but a system which is a processor. Data out. This one is a register that is written by the host to send the output. It is like this processor. This is the device. When the processor sends some data to be written onto it, it is stored in the data out. And then when the processor is reading from a device, it is it will be reading from data in. And when processor is sending some command to the IO device, it will be stored in the control register. And when processor checks up whether this device is available or not available, then it is stored in status. It checks it in status register. This way communication takes place. And this devices have addresses. Every IO device has addresses. There are two ways to actually get the data through addresses. One way is direct IO instruction, means directly the host read the address, provide the address, read the data, and provide the address and write onto that. There is another method which is known as memory mapped IO, in which processor has this memory interaction. This memory, there are few addresses in memory which are mapped to this IO addresses. Because memory is fast and secondary devices are slow, processor writes into memory, and from there it gets stored in the IO device. This is memory mapped IO. These are the addresses. Addresses are in hexadecimal format. And these devices have these addresses. DMA controller, interrupt controller, timer. Every device has, addresses. These are the IO port locations on PCs. This is partial list. It's not a complete, address list that has the addresses for all the devices. A few important addresses have been listed out here. The question that arises here is how a processor communicates with the device. What are the methods? For instance, with an analogy, we will try to understand these methods, the CPU and IO device communication. Consider that there is a teacher in the class and there are several students. And then teacher is explaining a concept and then asking every student whether the concept is clear, whether it is making sense to them. That teacher is doing, okay? This teacher, these are students, asking each and every student, okay, whether you understood or you have any doubt, let me clarify, like that. This is one method of communication in the class. Another method is what? This teacher would be explaining the concept, and what students does is whenever they get doubt, they raise their hand. And whenever a hand is raised, teacher will address to them, ask them what question doubt they have or what is their question. And there is another method in which teacher is explaining, and then teacher says there will be CR in the class. Okay, teacher appoints CR to note down all the questions and doubts, whatever queries they have, and then later the teacher will give solutions to all those problems, whatever they are facing. These are the three ways of communication within a class. Can anyone tell me which one is more efficient? The most efficient way of communication between teacher and students in these three modes I have explained to you? No one? Okay, let me tell you. In this, there will be a lot of time of teacher being spent on asking every student about their doubts and about their concerns, queries, about, you know, everything, whatever teacher would like to ask. A lot of time will be spent here in this case. In this case, what happens? Time will be saved because teacher is not asking. Whenever a student gets a doubt, student will ask. So this way, a lot of time gets saved essentially. This way, this is the third mode in which teacher is not at all asking or taking the questions directly. Rather, has appointed CR to take the questions and then CR collects all the questions and hand over to teacher, which teacher will clarify. So this way, teacher can do some productive work instead of asking and answering and wasting a lot of time. Teacher does something else and then CR collects all the questions and in a short time, all the answers can be provided. These are the three methods that are implemented like these. Similar to these methods are implemented between CPU and IO device. When CPU has to perform any operation, read operation or write operation, CPU repeatedly checks whether IO device is ready or not ready, whether it is busy or available. It keeps on checking the status of the IO device. And we know that CPU is the most expensive resource in the system. And CPU time has to be utilized efficiently. CPU time should not be wasted for the tasks that are not very productive. Therefore, what we have to do? We have to go for another method. Let us first look at first method in which CPU checks repeatedly about the status of the IO device, which is known as polling method. So these three methods, the first method you can compare with polling. Second one you can compare with interrupt driven method. And third one, you can compare with DMA. This is like interrupt. And this one is DMA, direct memory access. Let us look at the first method, polling. For each byte of IO, for every IO operation which is being done in at byte level, 8 bits you are transferring into IO device or getting from IO device. What processor doing is reading the busy bit from the status register, reading the status register until zero. Until it becomes zero. When it becomes zero, when it has completed its task, it becomes zero. Otherwise, it is one. So it keeps on checking. It checks. And then the second step is that the host sets read or write bit if write copies data into data out register. What does this mean? Whatever host has to do, whether it has to say, perform read operation or write operation. Based on that, appropriately bit has to be set. Where in the command ready bit, then controller sets the busy bit. Now, because there is a communication and data transfer being taken place, now the IO device turns its sets its state to busy, which is one. Now suppose when IO is set, status is one, again CPU has to perform any other task, again CPU has to start checking. So apparently it is wasting lot of time, CPU time, in this status checking task. And finally, controller clears busy bit, error bit, command ready bit when transfer done. When the transfer completes, then command bit, busy bit, error bit, all are cleared. Cleared means what? Zero. Set means it will be set to one. Clear means it will be zero. So zero means what does it denote? It denotes that the IO device is ready. Means available, means not doing anything. Yeah, then operation can be performed. This step one, wherein CPU is repeatedly checking about the status, is known as busy wait. And you see, busy wait essentially has a drawback. In which it is wasting CPU cycles because CPU is repeatedly checking, and we know that IO device is slower than CPU. So busy wait, this one is okay if the device is fast. However, it's quite inefficient if the device is slow. Okay, and then CPU can switch to other task if this status is not to be checked. Okay, then CPU can switch to other task and can do it. So this is polling method. What is the problem in this polling method? Which is the problem is busy waiting. Consider that CPU is waiting on a very slow device. It takes lot of time for the device to finish its operation, and CPU is wasting a lot of time. So that is the drawback in this polling method. The second method is an interrupt method. In the interrupt method, CPU does not checks this device status repeatedly. Rather, the device will inform the CPU whenever the device is ready for the operation. All right, so here CPU what it does is it is busy in its work. It is not doing busy waiting task. It is doing some, operation, some other operation. And when the device signals, give a signal in the form of an interrupt, when a device interrupts the CPU, stating that the device is ready, what the CPU does is CPU invoke interrupt handler. For every interrupt, there will be an interrupt handler. Interrupt handler, what it does is it addresses in the sense it performs the required task. Okay. So Interrupt handler is a program that can handle the interrupt. If in case interrupt is coming from input device, there will be a interrupt handler that handles the signal or interrupt from input device. There will be another interrupt handler for output device. Whenever an output device raises a interrupt or a signal, then that interrupt handler will take care of it. And we have a maskable interrupts. Sometimes what it does is CPU does is if CPU is doing really important task, extremely important task, then it disables interrupt. Then the IO device cannot interrupt the CPU until the CPU change the its status to allow interrupts. Okay, so there are maskable interrupts and there are non-maskable interrupts. There will be some interrupts which are very urgent and immediately need to be handled. Such interrupts CPU can accept. And then there will be a context switch when CPU is performing the when CPU is executing one program, and consider that CPU is here at this location and interrupt occurs. When interrupt occurs, CPU stops the execution of this process, the currently executing process, makes a context switch and switch to the appropriate interrupt handler that that handles this interrupt, and then resumes after it finishes handling of the interrupt. It resumes its execution from the next statement in the program during which an interrupt has occurred. Interrupt-driven I/O cycle. This flowchart, if you see here, there are two entities. There is one CPU, another is I/O controller. What the CPU does is device driver initiates I/O, and I/O controller initiates. Means when device driver tells the I/O controller, I/O controller is a component of I/O device that controls and manages the device. Whenever a CPU initiates I/O, the request through device driver reaches the I/O controller, which initiates the I/O. And then whenever input is ready, output complete, or error is, you know, error occurs, an input interrupt signal is generated. Means CPU initiates the I/O and does not wait for the device to finish its execution. What it does is it goes back to its work, it resumes its work, and then this I/O controller would be performing the task. And whenever it is ready, whenever it has done with its work, it generates an interrupt. So CPU receiving interrupt. What does when CPU receives interrupt, it transfers the control to interrupt handler. All right. So meanwhile, this I/O operation and this CPU task is being done simultaneously. An interrupt handler processes the data and returns from interrupt. CPU resumes processing of interrupted task. When interrupt occurred, CPU might be doing some task that got interrupted, and it resumes once interrupt handler finishes handling of this. And these are Intel Pentium processor event vector table. So in this event vector table, it maintains what is the vector number for an error. If there is a divide error, vector number would be 0. If there is a debug exception, its number would be 1. and interrupt mechanisms also used for exceptions. If any exceptions or error occur, even then interrupt is generated. And the system call executes via trap to a system call. What is a system call? It is the invocation of operating system function. For that also interrupt would be generated in the form of a trap. It is known as a trap because it is a software interrupt. It is occurring in software. And multiple CPUs can also process interrupt concurrently if you have multiple devices and multiple CPUs. Finally, the third method, which is known as DMA, the direct memory access. Polling method, you know, is also known as programmed IO. What is programmed IO problem? Busy waiting. What happens in DMA is there is a separate component which is known as DMA, direct memory access. So this DMA is in between CPU and IO device. This is CPU, this is IO device, and there is a DMA. What the CPU does is it tells the DMA what is to be done. Means if CPU would like to write large data onto the IO device, then it informs the DMA, please write down this data at this beginning address. It is specify the address. Then what DMA does is DMA writes the data on the IO device, and when it finishes, it informs the CPU that it has completed the transfer of the data. Okay, and then CPU is bypassed because DMA has taken the control to transfer the data. And DMA should know about the source and destination addresses, from where it should read the address and where it should write the address, and whether it is read operation or write operation, and how many bytes to be written or read. And it writes the location of command block to DMA controller. And then what happens? There is a little problem here, which is known as CPU cycle stealing. Why it is known as cycle stealing? Because when DMA is performing the operation, CPU have to wait, and therefore DMA is stealing the CPU cycles. And then when the operation is done, DMA informs the CPU that the read or write operation has been completed. Okay, the DMA version that is aware of virtual addresses as well is known as DVMA. This is the figure corresponding to DMA. You see here this first step one. There are six steps in this whole process of transferring of data through DMA. CPU device driver is told to transfer disk data to buffer at address X. Device driver tells disk controller to transfer C bytes from disk to buffer at address X. Addresses have to be specified. All right. And these operations are being done through device drivers. And then DMA controller transfer bytes to buffer X because that address has been specified. Okay. How many bytes? C bytes from disk to buffer at address X. So it starts transferring the bytes from buffer X, and it goes on increasing the memory addresses until C gets zero. If C is 100, then it transfers and it decrements, it becomes 99. Further, it transfers and decrements 98 until it gets zero. Then it stops the transfer, and it gives a signal to the CPU. When C gets 0, DMA interrupts CPU to signal the transfer completion. And this is actually fifth and sixth. After 1 and 2, disk controller initiates DMA transfer. Disk controller is the part of the disk that initiates DMA transfer. And fourth step is disk controller sends each byte to DMA controller. In DMA, there is a controller that manages DMA. There is a controller in disk that manages disk. And on top of controller, you have device driver. If you see here, step one, device driver is told. Who will tell device driver? The CPU tells the device driver to transfer the disk data to buffer at address X. And also, how many bytes have been specified. Then, disk controller initiates the DMA transfer. Disk controller, device driver, you know, it instructs the disk controller. You see the hierarchy, CPU tells device driver tells disk controller, and then what disk controller does, it initiates DMA transfer. When it initiates DMA transfer, it sends the data to DMA controller. And then DMA controller here, this one, performs that transfer operation until C gets 0. And when C gets 0, it stops the transfer and gives an interrupt to this CPU. Means give a signal. This is how the large data can be transferred from memory to disk or disk to memory without wasting CPU time. Application I/O interface. Okay, that is about that the topic of converge this in communication. Communication with the I/O devices. And do you have any doubt in these three methods? With that, those are really important.
No, ma'am.
Are they clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Then we will move on to the next topic, which is application I/O interface. This application I/O interface, it encapsulates device behavior in generic classes. You see, there is a keyboard, there is a mouse, there is a hard disk, there is a USB, there is a CD-ROM, and all operates differently. Right, and therefore this I/O subsystem needs to have a uniform interface, because to have that this device driver layer has been introduced that hides the differences among I/O controllers from kernel. What is a kernel? Kernel is the operating system. So from kernel, here, when you have a device, every device will have controller driver, like this, everyone will have. And then this device driver will hide the differences. From here, it will be same. In a similar manner, this host can access a keyboard or a mouse or a hard disk. The manner in which it is happening communication is same. How it is same? Because of this. And then every operating system has its own I/O subsystem and device driver. Devices occur in various forms. There are a variety of devices. What are they? They are character stream devices or block stream devices. Devices can be sequential or random access, synchronous or asynchronous, or it can be both, shareable or dedicated. And speed of operation of every device might differ. And devices can be read write only, write only. Can anyone give any example for these devices? For these types, example for these types of what do you mean by character stream? Character stream means it transfers you know, bytes, one byte at a time, whereas a block stream means it groups multiple bytes and transfers. Can anyone tell me which is character, which is block? Okay.
Character device. Port. Mice. Serial ports.
Character devices means
keyboards. Mic.
Yeah. Keyboard. Keyboard is character. When you what happens? You press a key, A or B. When you press a key, a single byte of information is being transferred. Okay. Can you tell me which is block stream?
Block devices includes disk drivers.
Block devices are disks. Disks.
We play CDs, DVDs.
And even hard disk. Those are block devices, means the transfer occurs in the form of multiple bytes grouped together into a block. And you have sequential and random access. Sequential, what it does is it transfers the data in a fixed order, that is sequential order, one after the other. Okay, 1, 2, 3, like this. And random access, directly any element can be accessed and retrieved. Can anyone tell me any example here?
For random access, keyboard is the best example, I hope, because we don't have the all the alphabets in a order.
Not that way. You know, from CD-ROM you can play any file. You can open any file from anywhere. Yes. That is random access.
No.
Okay. Sequential access could be magnetic tapes. Okay. And synchronous device, it performs the data transfer with predictable response time. And asynchronous device exhibits irregular or unpredictable response times. You can see that sometimes you know that within 1 minute you can transfer 1 GB of data. If it is fixed, then it is synchronous, and if it is not fixed, then it is asynchronous. You know, sometimes our devices like hard disk, it can be synchronous. We can predict in how much time we can read or write some amount of data into hardware. Asynchronous or modem, through internet, if we to perform operation, every time we can't be sure. It depends on the bandwidth and other factors. And then the shareable device and dedicated device. Shareable device, which can be used by multiple processes at a time. Dedicated device, which is used only by a single system. For instance, a printer, if you take, it can be shared by multiple devices. And if you take a example of a hard disk, which is built in, if it is outside and if you can shift it to other system, that is a different thing. But it is built inside the system. It is dedicated, and speed of operations of device varies, and device speed also determines how fast or slow operation takes place. If you consider tapes, magnetic tapes, earlier these were common for as a secondary storage device. This was extremely slow device. If you come to hard disk, it is fast, and if perhaps optical disks are more fast. So this way the operation speed differs among IO devices. And if you remember, there were CD-ROMs which are used only for read. You cannot write into that. There are some into which you can just write, you cannot read. There are few devices to which you can read or write, perform both the operations. This is the kernel IO structure. You have devices. These are the hardware devices which are at the lowest level. On top of these, every device has a controller. On top of that, you find every device has a device driver. And you see here, this device driver, kernel IO subsystem, and kernel, these are part of software. Whereas you can see in hardware, you have devices and device controller. Because device controller is also an electronic circuit board or a chip, which is embedded inside this device. So these two come under hardware, and drivers, IO subsystem, these are software. Based on the aspect, data transfer mode, you have a character or block. Examples are given here. Okay. This terminal, character means terminal. Terminal means you can have a monitor or a keyboard. And block, disk, sequential modem, random CD-ROM. Synchronous tape, asynchronous keyboard. Okay, dedicated tape, shareable keyboard. And device speed, we studied about latency, seek time, transfer time, and delay bit. Based on all this, devices vary. And read only is CD-ROM, write only is graphic controller, read write is disk. Okay, examples are given here. We got many examples, but few of them were different. Right. Then characteristic of IO devices. All the subtleties of devices are handled by device drivers. And the nuances of devices, they are handled by device drivers. And these are devices groups. Blocked IO, character IO, memory map, network socket. Okay, and then you have system calls, Unix system calls to send bits to device control register and device data register. And block and character devices, you can have raw IO, direct IO. You can have a read, write, seek, different operations you can perform on block and character devices. On network devices is nothing but through which you are sending the data to the other system over the cables. So they are, if two or more systems are connected by means of a cable forming a network through socket interface. Unix provide socket system calls through which you can send or receive data to and from other device. These are the system calls. Select is a system call, and there are variety of methods through which you can perform these communication pipes, FIFOs, streams, queues, clocks and timers. These are useful to maintain the current time and the timer and elapsed time. You can see how much time is elapsed if you start a counter, and then you can have a timer, and then you can also have a programmable interval timer. You can use timers. You have a library. Unix has a library for time.h, using which you can use time in the system to check the time, execution time, and then at the time it takes for input output operation and so on. And this is also IOCTL is a Unix system call that covers various aspects of IO, such as clocks and timers, and non-blocking and asynchronous IO. You know, blocking IO means the system waits for the data. This application is suspended, process suspended until IO completed. Until IO operation completes, if you have written a C program, if it says enter a number, and it waits until you enter a number. So it is actually suspended. It is not proceeding its execution. So that is known as blocking IO. In non-blocking IO, it requests for IO, but it does not wait. It does something else. And when the IO operation completes, that is returned to the application. You can see that the count of bytes read or written is given to the application once it is done. Asynchronous IO is that a process runs while IO executes. It means that asynchronous means here there are two applications. When one application would like to communicate to another application, in asynchronous mode, they need not be running at the same time. What happens is this can send some data which will be buffered and which will be given to the receiver once the receiver is up. You can see example like email, which is asynchronous, and telephone conversation is synchronous. You see that I am here and you are there at the same time. We started at 3:40, and at 3:40 I am present and you are also present in the same platform. This is known as synchronous mode of communication. In asynchronous mode of communication, when I share a link of this video, you can view it at any time. That is asynchronous. It is not time bound. That the communication can occur whenever the other person is, or other application or other process is ready. This process is running. It is running and it sends. And okay, for synchronous and asynchronous, figures are given. Here you can see the process is requesting and then waiting. In synchronous mode, process waits until this transfer occurs, completes, until it receives the response. This is response. Here there is a request for the data and starts waiting, and here there is a response. Until it gets a response, it is waiting. This is synchronous mode of communication, and it occur typically at the same time. And this is asynchronous mode of communication, in which this requesting process sends a request and does not wait. Okay, wait for very little time. It's like just send the request and then it receives acknowledgement sort of thing, and it continues with its task. Does not wait for the entire data transfer to complete. Later, when data transfer complete, it is returned to the requesting process. Okay, vectored I/O, it allows one system call to perform multiple I/O operations. That's vectored I/O. If there is a system call, for instance, a read VE in Unix, there is a system call using which this accepts a vector of multiple buffers to read into or write from. You can perform as simultaneously multiple I/O operations. You can give 3-4 bytes of data to be written at once. And this method is known as a scatter gather method. Means you can read from multiple locations and gather the data from multiple I/O calls. Kernel I/O subsystem also has to perform scheduling. You know scheduling very well. We studied CPU scheduling. We studied hard disk scheduling, disk scheduling. This scheduling is coming up with some order so that we can efficiently perform the operation. We know that in a queue, the requests would be lined up, and we saw that FCFS and FIFO, those methods do not give efficient results. Therefore, scheduling means picking up a process in some order so that eventually the optimized results is obtained. Like that, a kernel I/O subsystem has to perform scheduling for various I/O requests, including disk scheduling, because disk scheduling is also an I/O request. And then buffering, kernel I/O subsystem also stores data in the buffer, which is nothing but a part of memory. You can see there is this part of memory which is reserved as a buffer and which can be used between the devices for the transfer. One device can write into this buffer, another device can read from this buffer, another can write, and this one can read, like that. Double buffering is having two copies of the data, which is known as double buffering. And every device has a device status table that keeps track of the status of the device. You see device laser printer, status is busy. And then if request for laser printer arrives, it is queued. It is entered in the queue. And this disk, there are two disks. For disk, you need two, because its status is busy, the request is entered into the queue. Look at this is queue, like this, it is queue. So in this queue, there are two requests, you know, lined up for this disk because it is busy. And here there are the device transfer rates. You know, system bus has the highest transfer rate, and then it decreases as you go down the line, and you see hard disk and FireWire, SCSI bus. This is called slower transfer rates when compared to the system bus. System bus is the most optimized bus which can perform the data transfer at a high speed. And if you look at here, modem, keyboard and mouse are the slowest among all. And kernel I/O subsystem also perform the tasks of caching caching is nothing but having a copy. If this is our server and you access a web page frequently, then you can cache it here in your browser, a web page. And whenever you request for this web page, the request need not travel all the way to the server. This is not required. It is stored in your browser itself. From here only it will be opened. That is caching. Always there will be a copy available. There is another task of kernel IO subsystem, which is known as spooling. Spooling is used to hold the data until the operation is completed. If you consider this printer, to printer there is a spool attached. What does this spool do? Spool, whatever request arrives for the printer, it is spooled. And then this printer prints one by one, request one. If you open this printer task bar, in the task bar, printer tasks dialog box, then you can see multiple tasks lined up. Essentially, this is maintained by the spool. And this operation is performed by kernel IO subsystem, and it is known as spooling. Device reservation, it is like if you would like to perform an operation on a device which no other process should perform. You want this exclusive access to this device. This is known as device reservation. Error handling, while performing IO operation, there is a possibility that error might occur while reading, right, operation. Device might be unavailable. There might be some transient write failures. So for this, operating system has error codes or error numbers, which operating system returns when an IO request fails, depending on the type of failure. IO protection has to be done. User process accidentally or purposefully attempt to disrupt normal operation via illegal IO operation. There might be some evil processes, with ill intentions to perform illegal IO operation. For that, all IO operations are defined to be privileged. Privileged in the sense that all IO operations have to be performed through system calls, not directly. So there is this user mode, there is this system mode. Whenever user requires to perform any IO operation, user has to send a request through system call to the operating system. Operating system performs it. And operating system protects the devices. Use of a system call to perform IO, you see, okay, whatever I did here, this is user program, this one is user program, and this one is a kernel or operating system. Whenever user program invokes a system call, there is a trap. We discussed that trap is a software interrupt. Trap is sent to the kernel, and kernel handles it, performs IO in the second step, and third step returns the result to the user. And kernel maintains data structures. Kernel has to have information about all the IO devices, and for that it maintains all open, what are the open, here this is the data structures that are maintained by kernel IO subsystem or kernel. You see that there is a per process open file table. This is a system-wide open file table. Through this, it keeps track of what are the files or IO devices that are open. What is in operation, what is not in operation. All these are known as the structures that are maintained by the kernel. Okay, power management is about having some kind of cooling, and because computer devices use electricity and generate heat. It is actually not a domain of IO, but related to IO. That's why we say that we should have a cool environment for a computer system, because it is interacting with IO devices and generating heat, and you know, has to be cooled down. And this is also about power management and IO request to hardware operation. Whenever an IO request takes place, if you say that you would like to open a file, you are saying in a program to open a file, or through file menu you can open a file. Eventually this one has to be done you know, on hardware. If on disk a file is stored, so this one has to be through steps converted into a hardware operation. Okay, that is whenever you are trying to read a file from a disk, you have to determine which device is holding a file, translate the name to device representation, then physically read the data from disk into buffer, then make the data available to the requesting process, and then return the control to the process. Here you observe here, this is physically reading on the disk. IO requests are mapped to hardware operations through these steps. Here the life cycle of an IO request is given. Whenever a request is made, so what happens? A system call is invoked. If it is available, can already satisfy request. If it is available in the memory, then it can be directly returned. Yes means transfer the data. If it is yes. If it is no, then the whole operation has to be done. Send the request to the device driver. And this here kernel IO subsystem takes care of that. And then process request, device driver does that. And then interrupt handler, interrupt has to be generated because IO request has arrived. And then device has to be monitored by device controller. And then when IO is completed, it generates an interrupt. An interrupt is generated. Here, interrupt handler handles it, and then determines which IO completed. Device driver determines which IO has been completed, and then it is returned to the requesting process. Well, all this is nothing but having a IO request to getting the data. IO request is nothing but some kind of a data request. These apparently these steps are performed, and then it is returned. Streams. A stream is a full duplex communication channel between user level process and a device in Unix system. It is specific to Unix system 5, okay, and beyond, and some other Unix systems. So what is a stream? A stream consists of stream head and driver and interface, stream head interface, driver and interface, and zero or more stream modules between them. And each module has a read queue and a write queue. This is nothing but communication, you know, communication between the processes. How is it done? Through a stream. Now, what is a stream? It is a communication channel, like this, a channel. What does it have? It has a head interface, it has end, and then it has a queue. This interface, this stream might have queue, read queue, write queue. And then messages pass through this communication channel, which is a stream. And then this one is illustrated in this figure. This is a user process and this is a device. Here, user process and device communication occurs through streams. A stream has a stream head. This is a stream head. And this is driver end. Means driver end is connected to device. Stream head is connected to user process. And it has got queue, read queue, write queue. these are known as modules. These two are modules. What happens in modules? Whenever a user process reads the data, it is in this queue and sent to this queue, and it reaches the user process. And when it is writing through queues, it is writing onto the device. This is stream, and performance is not there in this. And this, with this, we have completed our unit 4, the second part, which is IO systems. Any doubt? In this chapter?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Okay. You just compare all the questions in the question bank with the material what we discussed, whether you are able to answer and you are able to understand. That way you can assess yourself before examination, and that way you can prepare yourself. Okay, let us begin our unit 5. Unit 5 has case studies. All through unit 1 to 4, concepts were covered, explored, you know, in a generic format. Now we'll look at specific examples in two of the most popular and widely used operating systems, which are a Linux system and Windows XP. Yes, case studies, Linux and Windows XP. Okay, I think the material which I have given is for Windows 7, because in 9th edition we have Windows 7. I'll share with you all Windows XP material, okay? Because here XP is given, mentioned in the syllabus. So you might be getting questions from XP, not from Windows 7. So I would share with you. A very popular operating system, which is Linux. We will look at this. What are its design principles? What are the modules in kernel? Kernel is the operating system core. How process is managed in Linux? How is scheduling performed in Linux, memory management, file system, input output, inter-process communication, network structure, security. All these are the operating system components and functions and services. Up to unit 4, we covered all these. What is scheduling, types of scheduling, what is a process, what are the process states, and what is context switching, what is memory management, what is virtual memory, what is paging, what is segmentation, file system we studied, file, directories, structures, allocation methods, and input output we studied. all this with respect to Linux, how they are implemented. You see that the objectives of this one is this chapter is to explore the history of Unix operating system and from which Linux has been derived. Okay, and we will examine Linux process model and how Linux schedule processes and look at memory management in Linux and explore Linux implementation of file systems and IO device management. History is that Linux is a modern free operating system based on Unix standards. It was developed as a small kernel in 1991 by Linus Torvalds. Linus Torvalds had developed this, and later several users collaborated all around the world to write different components of Linux operating system, and it is it has been designed to run efficiently and reliably on PC. The core Linux operating system is known as kernel. And then Linux has many distributions. Okay. Okay, Linux kernel, when it was developed in May 1991, its version was 0.01 and it had no networking and it ran on 80386. In 1994, a new version 1.0 Linux was released with these new features. It included networking protocol, socket interface, device drivers, enhanced file system, SCSI support, and 1.2 version in March 1995 was the final PC only Linux kernel. It supported all the features of PC, and the old version numbers are development kernels, and those with even numbers are production kernels. They follow this naming convention sort of thing, wherein odd versions are development kernels. If you take 1, 3, 5, and even numbers are production kernels which are in operation. And then Linux 2.0, it was released in 1996. It has new features like improved memory management, TCP/IP, and support for internal kernel threads. We learned about threads as well. And it was available for another models of computer system like this Motorola, SunSpark, Mac, and like that, kernel of Linux developed. It evolved with different versions, and it has got advanced features. As it was developing, multitude of features were being added. And this Linux system, this has got several tools. Okay, it is developed under Berkeley's BSD operating system, Nginx uses many tools developed as part of Berkeley BSD operating system. There are several tools. The idea is that this Linux system has got several tools for networking, for administration, for file management, for file transfer, and Linux distributions. You see, you have this Red Hat Linux. You might have heard about Red Hat Linux, Debian Linux. These are different distributions of Linux. So what you can do is you can install Red Hat Linux. It comes in a package. It has got all the components of operating system together. Licensing, it is distributed and under GNU, General Public License, which means that it has been set out for free use. Okay, this GNU, General Public License, set out by the Free Software Foundation. Okay, there is a foundation called Free Software Foundation, which has released this Linux under GNU GPL, General Public License. That's why it is known as open source for operating system. Its design principles, I try to learn these design principles. It is a multi-user, multitasking operating system. It supports many users and many tasks. Processes, and it has got a fully networking model, and its design goals are speed, efficiency, and standardization. And then it has got a library for threads known as POSIX library, and Linux programming interface adheres to SVR4 Unix semantics. You know, there are broad two flavors of Unix, SV and BSD. So this Linux adheres to SV flavor of Unix. These are the components of Linux operating system. You have loadable kernel modules, Linux kernel, system shared libraries. On top of it, you will find user processes which we run, user utility program, like compiler, interpreter, a text processor, different utility programs, okay, like compilers for translation, system management programs. You can manage the system, like you can connect to the server, and you can perform various other tasks on the system. So that comes in the system management program. Linux loadable kernel modules. Loadable kernel modules means this is the core. Besides the core, it has got several modules that perform various tasks, and they are loadable. Means they reside on disk. They can be loaded in the memory, okay, whenever needed. So they are loadable kernel modules. And what are the components of this Linux system? This one you see the kernel. What is kernel responsible for? Maintaining important abstractions, and kernel executes in kernel mode, and all kernel code and data structures are kept in single address space. And you see system libraries define set of functions. System utilities perform specialized management tasks. And user mode programs, rich and varied, including multiple shells like bone shell, bash shell. Dollar prompt you see, at which you can execute shell commands. Kernel modules. There are four components to Linux: module support, memory, a module management system, module loader and unloader, driver registration, conflict resolution. You have to load the module, you have to unload the module, you have to work with the drivers. If there is any conflict has to resolve, So these are all like management related tasks. Kernel mod, these are kernel modules. Module management, it supports loading of the module into memory and then allowing them to talk. Modules can, you know, like this module you can load, this module you can load. Means this module management does that, loading of the modules into memory, and then they can communicate. And module loading is split into two separate sections, managing section of module code in kernel memory and handling symbols that modules are allowed to reference. What are the privileges? In other words, what are the permissions? What it can access, what these modules can access. All this is maintained by module management. And then you have driver registration. It allows modules to tell the rest of the kernel that a new driver has become available. Driver registration, if suppose you you use a new device with your system, for this new device, driver has to be loaded. When the driver is loaded, it's like driver has registered and new device is accessed and used by this system. So registration is done in device drivers, file system, network protocol and binary form. This registration table includes the following item. There should be a table maintained here into which driver is registered and all these entities are placed in that. Conflict resolution is another kernel module. It is a mechanism that allows different device driver to reserve hardware resources and to protect those resources from accidental use by another driver. The conflict resolution module is aimed to prevent modules from clashing over access. If two modules would like to access one single device, then conflict occurs. And then conflict resolution prevents that. And then conflict resolution ensures that only one device, one module access that device at a time. So it prevents auto probes from interfering with existing device driver. It resolves the conflict with multiple drivers trying to access the same hardware, and it maintains list of allocated hardware resources. Driver reserves the resources with kernel, and reservation request is rejected if resource is not available. So directly a module cannot start accessing the device, rather it sends a request to this module. This module checks whether the device is resource is available. If resource is available, it is provided to this requesting module, otherwise module has to wait. That way conflict is resolved. Well, this is about process management. Process management means, what is a process? When a program is executed, it is in running mode and it is known as a process. And how a process is created in Unix? A process is created by a system call known as fork. Fork is a system call that creates a new process in Unix. And how a process is executed? It is executed by invoking exec. It is executed by exec system call. So process is created through fork, process is executed through exec. And Unix maintains every process information and process properties are grouped into three categories: this process identity, environment, and context. A process has been given identity, and in which environment it's running, what is its context, how far it has come. So what process identity three classes? first class is process ID PID. Credentials is what are permissions or privileges or rights of the process, that is credential. And personality means what is the process. Traditionally, it was not found in Unix system. In newer versions of Unix system, there is another property which is known as the personality of a process. It includes the personality identifier, and it is used primarily by emulation libraries to request that system calls be compatible. Okay, so because Unix occurs in various versions and flavors, personality keeps track of that part of process, you know, that indicate to which Unix version it can request, it can access, or it can communicate. Namespace is nothing but set of all the names, all the file names which is used in file system hierarchy. That is about process identity. Every process has a name also, which is part of namespace. Process environment, this is the second component, which means that process inherits environment from its parent. Whenever you call fork, when you call fork, system call, in a process is created which is known as a child process, and there is a parent process. Okay, from parent process you can create any number of child processes, and this child process inherits the environment of parent, the argument vector, the environment vector. Okay, and then process context. What is process context? When a process is running, what instructions have already been executed, what are the values of the variables after execution, and how much program has been completed, that all comes under process context. And it is used because the CPU perform context switch. A CPU executing a process one can switch to process two. So before switching, it saves entire execution information of P1, which is known as process context. And it has got structures, file table, accounting information, descriptor. All this related to execution. The process context, some process might open certain files and can use signal handlers, virtual memory. All this information is maintained. Processes and threads. We know that within a process, in a process, you can create any number of threads. Threads share process address space. And fork creates a new task with entirely new task context. Means fork is like, you know, it is creating a new task with its own identity. Clone creates a new task with its own identity, but is allowed to share the data structure of the parent. You see, clone and fork, try to understand the difference. Fork and clone, these are system calls of Unix, Linux. Fork means a new process is created. It has got its own structures, identity, its context. When a clone is executed, a new task is created. It has got its identity. It has got its PID, process ID. However, it can use the data structures of its parents. When it uses the data structure of its parents, it means that data structures are being shared among the child and the parent. Okay, so processes and threads have been done. Tomorrow we will resume from scheduling. We will start with scheduling. Yes. Tomorrow we'll start scheduling and we will complete this Linux system, and then we will look at Windows XP general architecture, kernel and NT executive. These three topics of Windows plus from this scheduling.
Okay, ma'am.
Is it okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, so I hope today's class is clear.
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. Then see you tomorrow. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye. Bye.